Neurotransmitters then are synthesized and stored. They're synthesized in the soma, transported down the axon, and stored in the terminal knobs, awaiting an action potential. As they sit there, the potential factor for them to fire or not fire is based on the threshold being reached or not reached. If the threshold is reached, an action potential is sent down the line, skipping over those nodes of Ranvier, right? You remember the myelin sheath? Causes some of those vesicles to fuse with the membrane in the terminal knob. They're going to dump them out. Once they dump them out, they're either going to bind to a receptor site on a postsynaptic neuron beyond the synapse, or they're going to be destroyed in the gap or somewhere around the gap, the synaptic gap, synaptic cleft, by enzymes, or they'll get re-uptaken, right, by an active process, protein pump, somewhere around the terminal knob. That's what happens to them. And that's how we affect them when we're using psychotropic medication. Anytime you use a medication, if you feel an effect, it's a drug. So if you're affected by it, it has drug capacity. Some of the drugs are relatively benign. We look at, like, caffeine is a pretty benign drug, but it has a drug action. You take enough of it and you will notice it. Sugar has a potential to act like a drug. In some ways, if you don't believe me, feed a bunch of candy bars to a four-year-old and see if they don't act differently. Right? They're affected. Okay? But when we're talking about manipulating neurotransmitters, we're usually doing it therapeutically, but drugs mimic those. When we get into that chapter, we'll see how dopamine can be released by certain kinds of actions on dopaminergic neurons, or these neurotransmitters can be mimicked by other chemicals. In other words, they act like those neurotransmitters, or they block the action of those neurotransmitters at various positions. Acetylcholine got a little asterisk beside it because acetylcholine was the first neurotransmitter that we discovered experimentally. We're looking at little frog hearts, Otto Loewi, which is a fascinating story that I won't go into. History is fascinating from the right perspective. Acetylcholine is involved in movement. In fact, you can't move without it. And if it's not destroyed in the gap when there's too much of it, you can't stop moving. I took a class from a brilliant pharmacologist, Dr. Floyd Domer, and he said he's seen the case of the acetylcholinase being inhibited. Well, if it's got ASE on it, right, you know that's an enzyme. So if you are going to inhibit acetylcholinase, that means any additional acetylcholine that's in the synapse doesn't get broken down, meaning there's more and more of it, and what you get is random, uncontrolled movement of every muscle fiber, no longer coordinated by the action of the brain. And he said it looks like worms under people's skin because all the muscle fibers are twitching randomly and independently. The way that you get coordinated movement is by your brain emitting, right, through efferent neurons, the signal that I want to raise my hand, and I do that through emitting acetylcholine onto the muscle groups that are affected. So in other words, I get a coordinated release to get coordinated movement. That's relevant to your life, if you think about it, and the kinds of things we can be exposed to in terms of toxins or drugs and other kinds of things. Movement is acetylcholinase or acetylcholine based. Dopamine. Some people say, technically, the only thing you enjoy is serotonin and dopamine. What do they mean technically? They mean that your experience of reward or feeling good is corresponding to a release of those neurotransmitters, right? There are others, but when you say, man, that feels good, whatever that is, you're talking about release of dopamine and other kinds of neurotransmitters. So sensitivity to reward, but also voluntary movement. For me to plan to walk across the stage so fluidly that I don't actually have to plan to do it, it just happens while I'm thinking of what I want to say next, while I'm saying what I'm thinking I should say now, right? That happens so fluidly that I don't notice it. But I have to have these neurotransmitters operating at all times to do anything that I consider to be normal. So we got dopamine, norepinephrine deals with mood and arousal. And serotonin you heard about because it's so much involved with mood, that people think of it as an antidepressant. Well, the early antidepressants, some of them anyway, were called monoamine oxidase inhibitors. They would inhibit the enzyme called monoamine oxidase. Well, both of these are monoamines. So what you got was both of them were not being broken down by the original purposed enzyme, so there were more of both of them in the system. And that caused some serious side effects, especially with the norepinephrine. Some dry mouth, some agitation, some other kinds of things that we'll talk about later in a more appropriate chapter. So that they figured out if you could just do the serotonin and leave the norepinephrine alone, you got a better effect with less side effects. There you got your selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, things called SSRIs. But now they've gone back to SSNRIs, which is to say selective serotonin and norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, but specific types of receptors are affected by different variants of the different neurotransmitters. So it's a lot more complicated. When somebody says chemical imbalance, don't fall for that. That's an oversimplification of what might be occurring. GABA, got a little asterisk. Gamma-aminobutyric acid is what it really is, but you don't need to know all that. GABA will do. Keeps you calm, right? We're going to talk about parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system, this inhibitory transmitter. Low levels are linked to anxiety. If you have high levels of GABA, you have low anxiety, low central nervous system activity. If you have low levels of GABA, you're going to have higher levels of central nervous system activity, which could be translated and experienced as panic, anxiety, exactly. So it depends on the person, it depends on how they respond, and not everybody has the same levels. You can look at that and go, oh, see, that's a chemical imbalance. But how did we get that to begin with is a big question. I don't know that serotonin, low levels of serotonin cause depression, for example, right? I know that associated with a lessening of depression for some people, heightening levels of serotonin seems to help. But not for everybody with every agent, right? And it could be that maybe depression is causing lower levels of serotonin rather than lower levels of serotonin causing depression. Remember the correlation does not equal causation statement we made in the research chapter? And it may be that something else is causing both, or that there's some kind of co-effect of multiple variables, not all of which we understand. So it's not exactly accurate to say chemical imbalance. What we can say is we can affect changes in levels of neurotransmitters that do have some outcomes that are measurable, but not for every people with all the same agents, and we don't have a full fix on how it gets started to begin with. That's a more accurate and less satisfying explanation. Endorphins, pain suppression. Runners high, they're getting high on pain. In other words, painkillers are built in. When we take painkillers, we're usually taking things that are either opiates, derivatives of the opium poppy, right? Heroin, morphine, codeine, or we're taking synthetics of those, right? Oxycodone, roxycodone, Vicodin, etc. Right? So you have molecules that affect neurotransmitters. Some of those are built in because they're neurotransmitters. Endorphins kill pain naturally. But when you're in extreme pain, there's not usually enough of them, and they don't act long enough to provide satisfying relief from pain. That's why you get this temporary runner's high, and then it goes away, and then you're just sore, right? But when you add additional agents, you can get additional effects. So when used appropriately, you can get pain suppression from analgesics, which are drugs that give you pain suppression. And drugs are chemicals. Y'all now know this.